sin, your righteous ways. God, lead us in your righteous
Church. It's great to be back for another week, and as I promised last Sunday, we find ourselves today inside our other church building at Edenkilly. Now, Vivian was quite correct when she said it might be a tad cooler here, so I hope you will forgive me for keeping my jacket on today. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Stuart Finlayson. I'm a soon-to-be probationer minister with the Church of Scotland, and I'm also a member of Dyke and Edenkilly Parish Church. a regular minister, Richard, has been enjoying his well-earned time off, and he will return to lead our worship again next week. Now, I must thank Norman Thompson from the Congregation of St. Lawrence for his thought-provoking question after the service last week. Now, Norman asked what my thoughts were on the current climate in ministry, as well as where I saw the church in the next 30 years or so when I begin to draw my pension. I tried my very best to reassure Norman and all of you that even though the Church of Scotland was in a season of change, most definitely accelerated by the global pandemic, it also meant a new season of opportunity and of possibility. But this needn't spell trouble if we just remember that we have a God who is alive, is very much involved in the daily workings of his church, and we know that in all things he works for good with those who love him, those he has called according to his divine purpose. Last week I spoke about God's commandments as they are described in Psalm 19. Although they are indeed trustworthy and perfect, we could just never hope to live up to them. That's the truth. We just don't have it in us. So we must go to Jesus to help us with this. Love the Lord with all your heart, strength and mind, and love your neighbour as yourself. These are the two greatest commandments. We will have our place in God's plan for the world, but we must return to Scripture to find what God has to say about all of this. And so today we are looking at the book of Nehemiah to see a true example of what it means to rebuild. Both Ezra and Nehemiah were given the responsibility to return to Jerusalem after a season of exile at the hands of the Babylonians and the Persians. I think it's fair to say that we are in a season of return to our own sacred places. Now, Ezra and Nehemiah also had the responsibility to rebuild once they got home. Ezra was charged with the rebuilding of the temple at Jerusalem. Nehemiah, however, went back to Jerusalem to rebuild the walls of the city. Now, obviously, I can't teach from the whole of Nehemiah, so today I will focus on the first three chapters, but I encourage you all to continue reading to the end if you want to get the fullest possible picture. But now let's take a few moments to unite our hearts, our bodies and minds, and pray. Let's pray together. Loving God and Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to come together, wherever we are, and whatever time this may be, to join as one, as your holy church, the body of Christ, and to share in our praise and worship of you. Through the reading of your word and singing to your glory. Lord, we confess that we do not have what it takes within us to be without sin. We fail you on so many occasions. We let you down and we neglect your standards. And so we come to you today repenting of all our wrongdoings and asking your forgiveness. Lord, we know that you heal all our prayers, both silent and spoken. And so today we claim for ourselves your promises and your love shown to us in the perfect and sinless person of your Son, Jesus Christ, who emptied himself, thinking nothing less than to make himself as we are, and gladly accepting our sins as his own, and for our punishment, dying on a cross in shame and in pity, only to defeat death. Lord, we commit this time to you and ask that the Holy Spirit would come to each of us in our own places and inspire us as we listen to your word. Allow us all to be filled with your peace as we say together the words of Jesus to his friends and his followers. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you all to sing in our first hymn this morning, which is another great hymn of the church. So please join and sing Lord of All Hopefulness.
Chapter 1. The words of Nehemiah, son of Hakaliah. In the month of Kislev, in the 20th year, while I was in the citadel of Susa, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that had survived the exile, and also about Jerusalem. They said to me, "Those who survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire." When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Then I said, "Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes be open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you, day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, 'If you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the farthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people, whom you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant, and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. I was cupbearer to the king.
Today's teaching comes from the book of Nehemiah. Now, the first thing we need to know about the book of Nehemiah is that it was not always a book on its own. It was once a part of a larger piece of writing, probably written by the priest and scribe Ezra, and it included the preceding book of Ezra as well. So the two books at one point were one piece of writing. And to put everything into context historically, we must first think again about the Exodus story. This very important event in the history of the Israelites happened around about 1445 BC, and it sets the scene for what will happen to the nation a few hundred years later. In fact, it will set the scene for the rest of the story of Israel. When God brought Israel out of slavery in Egypt and took them towards the Promised Land, he told them that if they were to break their covenant with him, that agreement between him and Israel that promised they would worship only Yahweh and no other gods, that if they broke that, he would no longer bless them and he would allow the nation to be taken into slavery. We read this in Jeremiah chapter 2. But despite God's warnings, the people of Israel and Judah, well, they chose to reject their God and participate in the worship of foreign idols and partake in practices that Yahweh found detestable. And true to his promise, God brought the Assyrians and the Babylonians to bear down on his people. But by the time we get to Ezra and Nehemiah, the tribes from both the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah have been in exile for about 130 years. Specifically, these books focus on three key leaders who led the rebuilding efforts. The first was Zerubbabel, who led the first return in 538 BC, and we find that in Ezra 1-6. Then about 80 years later, Ezra comes back to Jerusalem in Ezra chapter 7-10. And then about 13 years after that, Nehemiah comes to rebuild the Jerusalem walls. Now, Nehemiah was a cupbearer to the Persian king Artaxerxes, and this was a very important role, especially for someone who wasn't a native Persian, but an exiled Jew. Nehemiah's job was to taste everything that was put before the king at mealtimes so that there was no chance of the king being poisoned. But this man, who would have been handsome, cultured, knowledgeable in court procedures and well-spoken, able to converse with the king and advise him, along with all his responsibility came a lot of privilege too. So here we have an example of, once again, God has put his people in the very place he needs them to be. And although there might have been risk for Nehemiah, we know that God is faithful and just and will use us to work out his ultimate will for his people. Now, that is just a summary of who Nehemiah was, what he did, and what context we're reading from today. It's always good to go back and get a bit of a backstory, even just to refresh our memories. In chapter 1, which I chose to read from today, we see Nehemiah being met by one of his brothers called Hanani on a trip back from Jerusalem. Hanani informs Nehemiah that the city lies in ruins. Nehemiah is, well, he's overwhelmed by what he hears, and all he can do is go to the ground and weep. Now, this story suggests that at the time when the two brothers met, it was a fairly normal day. You know, we aren't told anything exceptional about what was happening, except that Hanani had returned from visiting Jerusalem. And so we should remember that even on the most ordinary of days, that God can and will call his people to him, to the places where he wants them to be, and use them in special ways. For example, David was called home when shepherding his flock, and on that day he was anointed king. Peter, Andrew, James and John were simply mending their nets on a seemingly ordinary day when Jesus called them to follow him. We just don't know what God might be saying to us through a friend or a relative, and so we must be sure to stay open to God's providential leading. But Nehemiah goes on to ask his brother further questions because, well, he truly cares about his heritage and his ancestry. By asking his brother for all the facts, Nehemiah illustrates what real care is. The fact that he doesn't just bury his head in the sand is really important, you know, because he wants to know exactly what's going on so he can make an informed decision about what to do next. So Nehemiah prayed, and in his prayer we see language that points to confession and repentance. But even as he is praying, notice how he says we and not they, because he identifies himself with the sins of an entire generation, people that he didn't even know. It would have been easy to look back and to blame his ancestors for all the trouble that Israel was now facing, but instead he looks within and blames himself. I wonder, too often we plan our projects and then ask God to bless them. But Nehemiah didn't make that mistake. He sat down and he wept. He knelt and he prayed, all with a strong and persistent faith. Martin Luther once said that faith is a living, daring confidence in God's grace. I couldn't agree more. After all, Jesus did say, "All things are possible to him who believes." He also said, "Living faith can move mountains." Now, at the beginning of chapter 2, we read that we are now in the month of Nisan. From Kislev to Nisan is approximately equivalent to about mid-November to mid-March in our calendar. So for 4 months, Nehemiah has been praying and fasting. Now, that alone is quite incredible. Realistically, I'm not sure that I could even say to have committed such a long period to prayer when I've been trying to deal with a difficult situation. Nehemiah gains official travel documents, resources and materials like timber from the king's forests. He even gets given a royal security guard. So with all this resource that he's collected, the work of rebuilding can now begin in earnest. 3 days after arriving in Jerusalem, Nehemiah sets out during the night to survey the state of the walls. He goes alone, we are told, choosing not to tell any of the Jewish officials, the nobles, or the priests just what he's doing. Well, at first, it must be said that taking 3 days to rest was a wise move. If leaders are going to be productive and successful in what they do, then they must take care of themselves. We all must take care of ourselves. But what I find most interesting from chapter 2 is the reaction of the Jewish nobility once Nehemiah tells them what they are going to do. Now, their reply is quite simply, "Let's start building. Let's start doing what we've been told to do. Let's begin this good work straight away." But by the time we reach chapter 3, the construction of the wall has begun. We find in the chapter one of those long sections of Hebrew names which might cause us to nod off. But a good friend of mine always says that if your name was in that list, then you'd want it to be read out too. In that long list, we don't just read about the names of those who are doing the rebuilding, but we also learn about their professions as well. To my mind, this speaks volumes to the world we are living in today. Because we read of priests with consecrated hands working alongside goldsmiths, perfume makers working alongside merchants, rulers of half districts of Jerusalem working alongside rulers of entire districts. Perhaps what we should take away from chapter 3 is that God calls who he calls for his purpose. Now, sometimes we might think that our skill sets aren't what he would require in a servant, but really, who are we to assume such a thing? I imagine the same with the goldsmiths. These men used to work with such fine materials and delicate tools, and they're now being asked to carry heavy stones and rubble from place to place, filling in the ground underneath them. In 1 Corinthians 10, we read, "Therefore, whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." Today, so many people have lost their jobs due to the coronavirus, and it's clear that many will have to reskill if they are to find lasting employment. This isn't going to be easy for many, and no doubt there will be a lot of worry and anxiety along the way. But here we see an example of what a group of people with a huge variety, a huge different set of skills and abilities, who are called by God, could do to complete his work and glorify him in the process. If we hope to rebuild in our own communities, then perhaps we should be so open to the idea of working in areas that we aren't so familiar with. Who knows, we might just learn something new and valuable about each other as well. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul compares individual Christians to members of the human body. Each member is important, and each has a special function to perform. You and I might have different talents or gifts with which we can serve the church, and each is just as important as the other, so long as we go out and serve the same master. I remember the moment when I realised that God didn't expect me to do everything in the church, but rather to use the gifts he gave me in the calling he's put on my life. Over my training, I soon discovered that in helping others to discover and develop their own gifts, they became stronger and more obedient to the Lord, and by their being equipped, we could accomplish more for him as well. The people involved in the rebuilding at Jerusalem finished this difficult task because they obeyed the same leader, they kept their eyes on the same goal, and they worked together to the glory of God. They were ready to rebuild, but not just for the sake of it. They rebuilt because there was a need, because God had put it into their hearts, into the hearts of his leaders, because in doing so, God would be glorified and his church would be stronger. But if all that seems like too much, just remember this. The walls of Jerusalem weren't newly built from scratch so that nothing familiar was left over. The walls were rebuilt using no new materials at all, just those which lay around their feet. It won't be by reinventing clever new things that we take away the church's problems. The only way that we can do that is by going back to old truths that made the church great in the past. But what we build might not look the same, but it will be made using the same strong foundations that were set long ago. Over the first three chapters of Nehemiah, we learn so much about what it means to start rebuilding in a time of difficulty and distress. We learn that we must first be open to the extent of what is going on around us, and then in all honesty and all humility, pray to God that we need his help. In our prayers, both long, patient and faithful, as well as short and direct, we must always believe in the providence of God, that he will provide for us as he sees fit and for what will bring about his purposes. We must trust that he can use anyone in any position he puts them in. We might think we have skills in some field, but the Lord may have another idea for us, and we should always be ready to accept where we are called to. We're all part of the body. We all have different roles, but we all serve the same master. As we go into the next few weeks and months, and maybe even years, I think we should be asking ourselves this question. What work is God giving us to do? What work is God giving us to do? It might be valuable for us to think about whether our work might include things we've been doing for some time, or might our work include something completely new. If we don't know how to answer this, then, like Nehemiah, we must pray about it. We must pray long and hard. Going forward, we will see many changes, but hopefully these will come from the good foundations the church has always been built upon, and nothing less than a full dependence on our faith in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. I'm going to finish with a piece of scripture. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labour in the Lord Jesus is not in vain. Amen.
Build a house where love can dwell, and all can safely live. A place where saints and children tell, and hearts learn to forgive. Built of hopes and dreams and visions, rock of faith and vault of all are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where prophets speak, and words are strong and true, where all good children dare to seek, to dream God's reign anew. Here the cross shall stand as witness and a symbol of God's grace. Here as one we claim the faith of Jesus. All are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Build a house where love is found in water, wine, and wheat. A banquet hall on holy ground where peace and justice meet. Hear the love of God through Jesus is revealed in time and space. Sharing Christ, the feast that frees us, all are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place. Let us build a house where hands will reach beyond the wood and stone. of tears and cries and laughter, prayers of faith and songs of grace. Let this house proclaim from floor to rafter, all are welcome, all are welcome, all are welcome in this place.
Congregations across Scotland are finding it difficult to collect free will offerings just now due to the pandemic. There is one way to make your donation, and that's by visiting the Church of Scotland website. You'll be taken to secure pages where you can make your donation safely and easily. Please think if this is the best option for you. We're still collecting our envelopes, and standing orders are also welcome.
Let's pray together. Eternal God, you are the maker of us all, and we are your creation. People formed in your image, as individuals, as community, formed and fed and furnished with understanding of who you are and of who and whose we are. We worship you today in recognition of your calling, of your communicating, of your caring to invite us to share in your creative and healing work. We are here because we have heard you speak in us and through others. Help us to ever respond to you and your invitation to your grace. God of all moments, of our days and our nights, you speak and you act in the world around us, not only to call your people to you, but also to direct and guide us in the way of healing and brokenness. Awaken us, Lord, to hear what you would say to us. Help us to open our ears, our eyes, and our hearts to your presence. Help us to know when it is your voice we are hearing, and help us to turn away from our own prejudices and desires. Lord, we pray that your church may rise up with renewed commitment in answer to your call, that your people may be instruments of your grace and love, that your church would come together in strength and knowledge, moving forward the way that you would have it. We pray for those who consider themselves inadequate and dismiss or avoid your calling in their lives. Give them a new vision, a vision in which you are their strength and their hope, a vision in which they can do the things which you call them to do. We pray for those who, in answering your call, must leave the known for the unknown, the oasis for the desert, the comfortable for the uncertain. Grant them courage and steadfast faith as they continue in their journey, in their own rebuilding efforts. We pray too today, O Lord, for those in want and in need, for those of us of our community who suffer in body, in mind and in soul. We remember before you all of those we know and who we don't know who have suffered and have died from the coronavirus. Loving Father, bless us all with an abundant faith, a fruitful ministry, a joyful life. Bless us and all those who gather together to continue the work of Jesus, who came to heal, to save, and to deliver us all. In his precious name, we pray. Amen.
Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong. Who holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we Christ he lives, Christ he lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with him, there we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore.
Joining our Sunday service again here at Eden Killie, along with our sister church at Dyke. It's been so lovely for me to come back and to lead you in our time of worship. It's crazy to think that in a few short months I will be a full-time minister, probationer minister with the Church of Scotland. And so I would ask you to maybe say a prayer for me and my family as we go into these last stages. Things are really tough just now for everyone. No one is excluded from that. But there's always hope on the horizon. You know, today we have the hope of a vaccine program which has begun in earnest. And I know many of you will have had your jab by now, which is excellent news for all of us as we begin to come out of these restrictions which we've been living these past months. But as a church, we have greater hope. We will no doubt spend some time surveying and evaluating things wherever we find ourselves in the aftermath of COVID-19, but we will draw on the strength and the love of God and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Because our greatest hope of all is the hope we have in Jesus, the eternal hope that he gives us through his defeat of sin and death and his resurrection to everlasting life. Not one of us can live up to the law that God has given us. It's like holding up a mirror on our lives and seeing that we just don't have what it takes. But we have Jesus, our brother and our saviour, who through, well, nothing less than humility and grace, took everything that was owed to us, all our punishment for turning away from the Father, and bore it himself on the cross. It's finished, he said. And in there, we find the hope that can never leave us. So thanks again, and I look forward to seeing you all soon, hopefully in person, perhaps enjoying a bite and a blether when we can do so. Who knows what will be except God himself. You are the body of Christ. May you have the heart of Christ, tender for mercy. May you have the eyes of Christ to see a world in need. May you have the feet of Christ to bring good news. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, this day and always. Amen.